Hi, I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Hi, everyone. Today I'm talking with Dr. Evan Adams. Dr. Adams is with Indigenous Services Canada. You may also remember him from the movie Smoke Signals. Today we're talking about racism in healthcare in Canada and what his hopes and dreams are for the future. Hi, Dr. Adams. How are you?
Please call me Evan. Like a lot of people, I feel like I know you.
Oh, I feel like I know you too. You have, first of all, we have some friends in common, which you probably don't even know about. And your face is very familiar to a lot of people because before you became a doctor, you were in the arts. And I think a lot of people might recognize you from Smoke Signals. Yes. Do you get a lot of people recognizing you?
It was astounding, especially when Smoke Signals came out. Smoke Signals came out when I was just starting medical school. And for many, many months, even a few years after, a lot of people would recognize me and they knew me as an actor and they'd be like, "What? Why are you dressed like that? What are you doing here?"
Are you playing a doctor? Why? What is going on here?
They really, and I would say, "No, really, I'm studying to be a doctor." And they would look at me like, "Wow, he's in a different reality than the rest of us."
But what a life, hey? I mean, honestly, Evan, like you are an actor. Did you do? I know this sounds like a pickup line, but did you ever do any modeling?
No. Oh my gosh.
No, it does sound like a pickup line. But I ask because I've been thinking about our conversation, right? And I am not kidding. I saw a bus go by and there was an ad for insurance or something. And I was like, that looks like Evan. And I thought, is he still modeling and a doctor? And, okay, so you're not modeling right now.
No, but you know, as an actor, they would sometimes use your image for things, but I would never have called it modeling for sure.
Okay, let's be serious now and talk about you and your, I mean, this is, so tell me what it was like growing up on the Sunshine Coast. Did you know you wanted to be an actor? Did you know you wanted to be a doctor? What was life for you like as an Indigenous boy living on the Sunshine Coast?
Well, first of all, I just want to say I'm really happy to laugh about things, even if we're talking about serious stuff. And I hopefully we'll talk about Indigenous health, which, you know, can be quite serious. But yeah, as a kid, I'm surprised. When I was a teenager, I met an actor, Margot King, and I didn't even know that we were allowed to be actors. Like, that's how naive I was. I thought, wow. Oh, they let her do that. That's amazing. And my life has been slowly learning that. Well, yeah, actually, no, people will let you. People will help you. Of course, some people are terrible, but some people really are very interested in seeing you do well. So that was really a very important part because it does take a lot of investment, I think, to have someone work in the arts and to have someone go through medical school, right? It takes a lot of people. It takes a village.
Yes, it really does. So tell me about your big break in acting.
Well, I was studying biochemistry in Montreal,
and just biochemistry, no biggie.
I was in my second year. I was walking down the street Saint Laurent. If you've ever been to Montreal, and I saw a sign. It said classes, that's all I did was take classes. So I just stopped, and it was acting classes, and it was a casting agency. A woman came out immediately as I was just standing looking at the poster, and she said, "Are you an actor?" And I just lied. yes. She said, "Can you come and audition for me tomorrow? I'm trying to cast this film," and clearly she'd been having trouble with it. And so the next day I went in, I skipped class, and I was cast like in the second lead. It was just really,
my gosh.
And you know, I was 18. I looked 16. I was a university student. I thought I was, I could have been an English major I thought this movie stuff is easy. It's fine. Yeah.
So I just That's unbelievable. That is basically what people dream of having happen, right? And it happened to you.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. So did doing that film That was for Smoke Signals, right?
No, that was...
Oh, it wasn't.
No, it was a movie.
Oh, I thought that you were, that was your right out of the gate. It was Smoke Signals. I'm like, wow, no. You have horseshoes.
No, it was a movie called Toby McTeague. It was a French-Canadian film. And once I did that film, and seriously, I literally bumped into the camera doing one take of a scene. And I thought, I have to study. Like, if I'm going to do this, I'd better get some skills. So I went to theater school. So then I went to theater school and I kept working and going to school. And eventually, just before I graduated from theater school, I was just working so much. I didn't actually graduate from that theater school. But I learned a lot and I just absolutely fell in love with acting when I was in theater school, for sure.
Oh, that's so great. So then were you always planning on going to medical school? Is this something that you dreamed of or?
It's something I dreamt of once I hit university, but it was really a heavy burden because so many people said to me, oh, you have to get some training or a degree and then come back and help the people. And when you're a teenager, that's a really, that sounds like not a lot of fun to go to university and come back and be in service and work really hard. And acting just seemed like so fun, exactly the opposite of responsibility. And it was really fun. But when I was about 30, I thought, this dream of going into science, of being a doctor, I have to do it now or I'm going to age out. Like they'll just say, you're too old to come to this school. So Smoke Signals had just come out, or actually I had just shot it and I was applying and it came out at the same time as I started medical school. And people were saying, wow, it took you so long to get a leg in or to get a foot in the door. And now you're going to switch? And I said, yeah, I can't live with not trying to be a doctor. Mm-hmm. I'm glad it's working out. I could easily have not worked out.
I think it is working out for you. Working out quite well. Because when I look at it's hard to keep up with your resume as a doctor because you are busy and you have had all these different roles. And a lot of the roles have been working alongside, you know, government partners. Yes. So you were the deputy, I'm going to get this all wrong, but you were the deputy provincial health officer.
That's right.
Right? You were appointed as that.
Yes.
So what does that mean?
So Bonnie Henry and I were deputy provincial health officers together. You know who Bonnie Henry is. She's now the provincial health officer, right?
I do. Yes.
So her and I were deputies together under Dr. Perry Kendall. And that was amazing. What a great mentor. What a great man. Taught me a lot about public health, which is looking after, you know, large populations. And so that was an incredible role where you just learned to help. It's not the one-on-one of being in clinic like most doctors do. It's, you know, you helping lead much larger efforts. Well, not that it's larger, but larger groups at least.
So, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. So tell me, when you're in a role like that, do you feel... and? You know, you're an Indigenous man who is, and I'm going to guess that have there been other Indigenous physicians in that role as deputy?
No, there haven't. No, and did I feel strange about it? I did sometimes. On the other hand, I thought, we Indigenous people have to be given some authority to work on those problems. So.
Exactly.
There should be lots of us working on it. So I just saw it that way as opposed to thinking that I was fancy and smart. You know, Bonnie Henry is utterly brilliant. And my gosh, she works so hard. And it was really a good lesson to be there and to see others, you know, work so diligently helping others. I thought, that's what I want to do. I sleep at night knowing that I'm trying to help all the time.
Right. And I guess, you know, the reason I ask you that question is because, yes, I would think that there would be other Indigenous doctors that would be put into roles like this because, you know, it can't.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it can't. It's been, how do I say this? We have racism in healthcare. And how can that change, or how can we do better if we only have white doctors in places of you know, decision making and public health, really, right? Like you described, exactly. Right? Public health is a huge responsibility. You are looking out for everybody.
Yes. You know, when I was in medical school, we had the first female dean of medicine in 1999 when I was in med. And can you imagine that there had never been a woman as a dean? It just shows you that, you know, power, authority, work, responsibility, decisions about what is the work needs to be shared, right? It can't just mm-hmm. be one small group of people saying, well, we'll make decisions for everyone.
Well, especially when you don't know how different groups of people, cultures, religions, their way of life, whatever it might be, right? Everybody's so different.
Yes. I just remember once being in labor and delivery, and this older nurse was saying, oh, when we were young, we would tie women onto the bed so that they would stay on their backs when they were delivering babies. And I said, you would do that to a woman? And they said, yeah, because that's, you know, that's how it was supposed to be. You were supposed to deliver lying down on your back and not, you know, sitting. And I thought, see, that's when you're not asking the patient what they need. And of course, you need to ask patients, how can we help?
Yeah. And also, who decided that delivering that way was a good idea? I don't think it was a woman. You know? Oh, my gosh. There's so much to talk about with this because before we get into you have a new role now. Now you are not working provincially. You're working federally. You're now with Indigenous Services Canada.
Yeah. So when COVID hit, all of our work in health changed. We all, like so many of us, just switched over. And so I was sent to Ottawa to work federally on First Nations, Inuit, and Métis COVID health issues. You know, I was doing other related things because everything's related to health. But I went over to try and help with that. And that's been quite a big job for the last 2 years.
No kidding. So tell me some of the things you would work on in that role. Like give us an idea of what that means. Because I hear Indigenous Services Canada, it sounds like a government agency. It sounds, I don't really know what happens.
Ah, well, I know it's really weird to look back on COVID, but if you can remember, we had this very strange disease where we had to figure out what's the best way to avoid getting it, what's the best way to take care of someone if they get it, how do we rearrange the system so that doctors and nurses and other personnel are in less danger when they're caring for others, what kind of equipment do we need, let's develop a vaccine. Oh, okay, so we found a vaccine that we can live with, how do we get them into arms, and we're going to prioritize certain populations before others, younger people will wait because we have to figure out what's the best. So that was a lot of the work. It was very operational, as in let's get all of these things in order so that the people will have access to them. It was quite an effort.
So were you responsible, or are you responsible, obviously not by yourself, but for First Nations across the country to receive the COVID care they needed, or like?
Yeah, there are three major partners. The First Nations, Inuit, and Métis themselves, like their community leaders, their community level, you know, teams with nurses and the like, they're part of it. So they're the First Nations team. And then the provincial team who run all the hospitals, hire all the doctors, they're there. And then the federal government who supplies a lot of the funding and who provides policy that we make decisions and policy recommendations to the provinces. So those three teams have to coordinate their hundreds, thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of staff to work together to get all of these pieces of work done.
It sounds like a lot of paperwork.
It's more like a military operation. It's probably a more appropriate description. Yeah.
Wow. So how does this feel as, you know, you're a medical doctor in this role that, and you're not seeing patients one-on-one, right? This is, you're now removed from that and you're working in a much broader, higher level operation, I guess. Yeah. I don't know what else to call it.
Yeah.
How does that, like, do you feel like you're making a difference or is it hard to tell because you're so, do you know what I mean? It's so, I don't know how to put this into words because when you describe it, it sounds operational.
yeah, I know. All of those roles were important, just like in a hospital. The person who cooks your food, are they less important than the doctor who makes the diagnosis or the nurse who actually, you know, gives you the medication or helps you when you're in pain?
Yes.
You know, the roles are supposed to kind of move together. And I know some like vaccinators, like doctors or nurses who are actually putting needles into arms, they thought that was the most important work. But, you know, from my point of view, it's like, well, actually, you know, the driver who drove the vaccine, the inventor who did the research, the clinical research on the vaccine, the people who made the policy, like no one will have to pay for the vaccine. Those are all important pieces. So
yeah.
It's quite a large effort, I think, by the nation, right? Ordinary yes. citizens, we had to trust them to wear masks, to socially distance, to look after each other when someone was sick, but not in hospital, right? So we did rely on each other a great deal. And Bonnie Henry was good at enunciating that and saying, you know, let's be kind. Let's mm-hmm, do the right
mm-hmm,
thing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So let's talk about racism in healthcare. What, especially when it comes to Indigenous people. So what does, if you were to describe to somebody what racism in healthcare looks like, how would you describe it?
Well, we have a couple of seminal cases, like Brian Sinclair, who was in an eMERGE department in Winnipeg, where he was really ignored to death, or Joyce Echequan in a Quebec hospital, where a nurse and an orderly just berated her. And they said, you know, what is wrong with you? Your life should be different, you know, as she lay there dying, when they were both really vulnerable and in need of help. So instead of actually seeing the patient, the caregiver is seeing their own generalization, simplistic generalization, even malevolent generalizations. And that means the patient is now going to not receive the level of service that others receive. They're going to be underserved, or they're not going to be served at all. Or sometimes even someone is going to be malicious. Like, you know, yelling at someone when they're dying, can you really say that you were helping or that you were actually doing something bad?
When Joyce... when that video was released by her family, it was, I couldn't believe what I was seeing. I had no idea that that could happen in a hospital setting. Obviously, as you know, a white person, we don't receive racism, at all, let alone in a hospital setting. I think that many of us have this idea that hospitals are safe and sacred, and if you go there, you will get the help you need no matter what. But we know that's not true for everybody.
Yeah, it's one of our basic tenets is to do no harm. And yes, hospitals are supposed to be safe. If they're doing it right, you should not be belittled. Or debased or humiliated because you're there seeking care. That should not occur. Some healthcare workers need to be told, we hear something bad happened. What happened? And it's a difficult situation where, you know, you have a staff member, you know they can do better, and you have to say to them, how are we going to do this better? And then you have to speak to their boss, like maybe the chief of staff of that hospital, and say, what happened? How are we going to make this better? And then that chief of staff has to admit that they can do better. Making change, making improvements in your staff is hard to do. And that's the challenge of transforming the system so that it's more patient-centered, so that it's kinder, so that it's safer, and where it doesn't humiliate people because of their gender or their sexual orientation or the color of their skin or their culture of origin. A lack of safety should not be occurring in the healthcare system.
No, but how do you change that when, you know, as we just said, you were transforming the system, but how do you transform the system when we know that we have systemic racism and our healthcare is run by, you know, tens of thousands of people across this country, right? Like whether, like you said, making your food, taking your blood, admitting you into ER, whatever it might be. And I mean, I ask you, it's a big question, but it's, how do you start to transform people's ideas so that when an Indigenous woman walks into the ER, somebody doesn't ask her how much she's had to drink before they ask her what's wrong? You know what I mean?
Yeah. And
that's systemic racism.
That's right. And part of the work is training, is helping that worker understand that their frame of reference is only their frame of reference. Like sometimes asking people if they drink is part of a standard set of questions where you're ruling out issues. On the other hand, sometimes people go there because they're generalizing about, you know, the color of the skin of the person who's in front of them and not really seeing the person. So part of it is training. Part of it is policy, right? A worker should not be able to sexually harass, be violent towards, name call a patient. Like, it should be clear to that worker, you know, this workplace racism, this workplace cruelty to patients, it's offside, and you agreed when you came to work here that you would not do that. So we have to kind of explain that, and there are going to be situations where it's unsafe, and there need to be processes for those workers to go into where they're asked, you know, can you change? And workers can change. Workers can improve and do better. But you need to help them get there.
Mm. Yeah, it seems like a daunting job, you know, it really does, because I'd like to say that it should be an easy thing to teach people, you know, how to be kind and not racist. But I mean, when it's systemic, right? Like when we don't even know that we're your ideas, right, of maybe who somebody is or who you think they are or what they might be doing are actually have nothing to do with that. It has to do with something that you learned a long time ago that's embedded in your brain that you didn't even know you were learning, right?
Yeah, and you can unlearn things and learn a new way of doing things. So for instance, you know, men my age grew up in a sexist society. Like I know that. I grew up with four sisters. I know that society was crueler to them and gave me more opportunity than them. It's very clear to me. And then, so when we have male healthcare workers who can't learn to be respectful and egalitarian to women, you have to say there's something strange here that's going on. We used to call it disruptive. We would say that staff member is disruptive. Part of me is thinking, no, there's something a little bit hateful in them. There's something odd going on in that worker. And when you have 100,000 workers and one of them is being hateful, you can say, maybe you shouldn't be here. Maybe this is not the work for you, because we really need for this place to be safe.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So let's talk about birth alerts. That's a that's something that we can talk about because it still happens today in Canada. Yes. I know it still happens in Vancouver. So for somebody who doesn't know what a birth alert is.
Yeah, birth alert. It's when a person is giving birth and the healthcare staff feel like that eventual baby is going to be endangered by that parent. And so they alert social services to come and watch over or apprehend or speak to that person or that family because someone has alerted the system that that baby is in danger. It used to happen quite a lot. We now know that children who are torn from their families actually do quite poorly. We saw that, we've seen that in a number of studies. So you have to think once, twice, three times before you tear a baby from their family. It shouldn't be happening casually or all the time. It should be happening very little. And of course, we're all concerned about baby safety. But birth alerts actually were doing more harm than good in lots of situations. And so that policy has to be rethought and those personnel have to be retrained. And in my mind, you know, why is a healthcare worker making that kind of call? They should be in consultation, say, with social services or a child advocate so that that isn't occurring. Anyway, that seemed to happen quite a lot to Indigenous people when they were giving birth. And it was really, it really had some tragic outcomes for sure.
Mm-hmm. And it still does happen. We know it still happens. And so you think that that has to start at a policy level too, right? That has to.
Actually,
because it can't, that is described as, that is racism, is it not? If somebody's deciding this is an Indigenous woman, she's having a baby, I'm calling social services because she, like you said, somebody's making a call here that this doesn't seem right. And
it's really quite terrible. And in the province of BC, there has been a lot of work in trying to dismantle that, that process. So that it's different, so that, you know, because sometimes there are parents who can't look after their children. There has to be another process to identify them, to help them, to invest in those families, you know, so that that baby's safe, than calling social services to tear a baby away from, you know, a vulnerable young person who's often they're young people, a vulnerable person who's just given birth or is in the process of giving birth.
Yeah, because I mean, a lot of people describe the child welfare system in this country as being the new residential schools.
It's definitely a system that could do with some improvement. It's definitely a place where there's a lot of action and where people are reviewing, you know, what's the quality of service. There are lots of people who said the quality of service is not strong enough and we need to make change.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that changes, Evan, by having more Indigenous leaders in healthcare?
Yes, absolutely. Even just simple things like me being a medical student on a ward and the doctor saying, you know, what are you going to do about all these Indigenous women having babies? I could say, is that a value judgment? Is that really a thing? I'm from a big family. We've always had big families. Like, you're really making a generalization about a group of people, and that's the definition of racism. So why are we having this conversation, and why are you bringing this up? It's actually not your job to comment on people's families. And lots of women I've seen now from being with women in labor and delivery, a lot of people have opinions on when they should have children, how old they should be, how much money they should have, what they should eat during their pregnancy. And so there are people in their face saying, this is how you should be in your pregnancy. And it's very bizarre because really that's, you know, a very intimate thing for a woman, right? A very personal experience. There shouldn't be people commenting and, you know, that means she's in an unsafe environment if people are on her trying to interfere with her life.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Very much so. So how do we, oh, you know what? I need to mention that we keep talking and talking and talking. I need to mention that I know exactly. My next question was going to be, how do we get more, Indigenous youth interested in medical school and all that? And I'm just going to say that we always ask our guests to choose a nonprofit Canadian organization where we donate, re-give them $500 in your name. You chose the Indigenous Physicians Association of Canada. And what do they do, Evan?
Well, the Indigenous Physicians Association of Canada is interested in the well-being of Indigenous medical students, medical residents, and physicians. And, of course, interested in improving the health of Indigenous peoples. Part of that work is promoting health careers for Indigenous peoples, and hopefully we would have more Indigenous physicians. Like in BC, First Nations physicians are 0.32% of the population, even though First Nations are 3.8% of the population. So we should have about 11 times more First Nations physicians than we have. So there is some work to do then. As demographic representation is important. Like, for instance, lots of women like having women physicians, and ergo, Indigenous people like having Indigenous physicians. They feel like they're understood better. And that's a very common request, is to have a physician who can understand you a lot easier, so that you're not having to explain things in huge detail.
Mm-hmm. And when you, Evan, when you were growing up and going through all of this, did you face a lot of racism when you were in medical school?
I have never faced more racism than in medical school. Isn't that terrible?
Wow.
Even in the mean streets of the downtown East Side, I never faced more racism than I did in medical schools and the hospital system. Yeah, it's really strange, because my colleagues are generally very bright and very well educated, but the system is extremely harsh. So we can do better, and that's definitely part of my work as a public health physician, is to support the workforce, or the development of the workforce, and to try and help make changes so that more Indigenous people can go through medical school and residencies and find work as doctors.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And when you think about, COVID, I don't like to say it's over. Like, a lot of people are talking about it, but we've been through a lot in the last few years, right? We've been through a lot, and people have changed, I think. I hope for the better. I think not everyone, but I do hope people have changed for the better. Seen how fragile life is, understood that we're all in this together. I hope, these are the things I hope for. What do you think about the next few years moving forward in your work, in what you do? What are some of your goals as you move forward? What would you like to see happen?
Well, part of the immediate work for me is to help stabilize healthcare workers, because we're facing something called the Great Resignation. We've been called upon to help save the day. We've been literally working double time. I've worked double hours for 2 years than I used to work. And we're a bit droopy. And we're not just physically tired, but tired in our spirits and in our hearts and with our compassion. So how do we get workers to stay at work? And that means helping them be in a better situation. Another part of it is Indigenous health has to rise up. Like, equity is important. If I'm just helping people who already have good health, and I'm not helping people who don't have good health, then I'm actually part of the problem. I'm making the gap between the haves and the have-nots even wider. So, and I'm happy with that work. I'm happy to help Indigenous populations with their health. And that's a lot of people. That's, well over a million people in this country. So I feel like my work is cut out for me, and I'm trying to bring along other workers so that they can help. And those are just two goals, and there are hundreds of them. Because all that old work we used to do 2 years ago, that has to pick up as well. We're behind.
Isn't this the truth, right? It's like we've had this moment in time and now we need to regroup and catch up and still move forward. And yeah, I can't thank you enough for taking the time to chat with me. I've been wanting to chat with you for so long, and I really have. And so it's really nice. People I know have always described you as being just really funny and charismatic and incredibly smart. And you are definitely all of those things. So I really appreciate it. I want to let people know that your website is drevanadams.ca, and all of Evan's information is there. And your Twitter account is Dr., all spelled out, Dr. E Online, Dr. E Online. And Evan, are you still doing motivational speaking? That's what it says on your website.
I do go out and I speak to groups. Absolutely. I get asked to everything from Miss Brown's grade one class to, university lectures. And
I love it. You do good work. You do really good work, Dr. Adams. And I really appreciate it. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. And I feel like I've made it. I've spoken to you. This is wonderful.
Oh, stop.
Thank you, Tamara.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening to another episode of TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Be sure to subscribe so you can join us every Tuesday for another conversation. You can also check out our website, telus.com/podcast, and subscribe to our YouTube channel at TELUS Talks.